So I'm running on my battery of the laptop, and hopefully, at least, you know, throughout our class, it will continue. I hope so. All right. So yesterday, we discussed about the lifting condensation level, the pseudo adiabatic process, right, and the equation for pseudo adiabates, pseudo adiabatic process, right. So, who can tell me what is pseudo adiabatic process? Can somebody tell or explain what is pseudo adiabatic process? Anybody? Otherwise, I will name. My class yesterday, we discussed about the pseudo adiabatic process, right?
Yes, so sir. Can Barsa tell us, sir, in that process, the liquid condenses and is assumed to be removed as soon as it is formed.
Okay, so the condensates are assumed to fall down, right? As rain.
Yes.
Yeah, in the pseudo adiabatic process, and so it is a irreversible process, right?
Irreversible process, and also it is not truly adiabatic because we are removing the liquid from the parcel, so it is not fully adiabatic.
Right. Right. So good. So that is the pseudo adiabatic process essentially, right? So today we shall continue further. Okay. Yesterday we saw about the equation of pseudo adiabatic process, but today we shall try to go further deeper and derive the pseudo adiabatic lapse rate or saturated adiabatic lapse rate. Okay. Saturated adiabatic lapse rate. We have seen earlier and also derived the dry adiabatic lapse rate. Does anybody remember what is the expression for the dry adiabatic lapse rate? Can anybody remember what is the expression for the dry adiabatic lapse rate? Anybody? At least you know the value, right? Dry adiabatic lapse rate, you know the value, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What is the value of dry
adiabatic lapse rate? Around 9 to 10 degrees Celsius per kilometer.
So, this is generally denoted by gamma D, right? What is the expression, formula for that? What is this formula for that? G divided by Cp. We had discussed about this earlier. We had seen the derivation of this dry adiabatic lapse rate is equal to G by Cp, which is approximately equal to 9.8, right, Kelvin per kilometer. That is the lapse rate. Do you remember that? So this is the formula for the dry adiabatic lapse rate. Okay. Similarly, today we shall derive or see the derivation of how, what is the moist adiabatic lapse rate. We know its value is approximately 4 to 6 degrees centigrade per kilometer. But what is the expression for this? This expression is much more complex than this expression. Okay, we will see that today. So, is this slide visible? Whatever I am writing on the board, why is it visible? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. So, now let's see the derivation of this pseudo adiabatic lapse rate. Okay. So, in the PowerPoint visible to you? Yes or
yes.
No?
Yes.
Yes,
sir.
And I'm also visible, right? My live photo is also visible, right? Both the things?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, I have to confirm this because I've seen in the YouTube sometimes my photo is missing and only the profile photo is visible. So I have to confirm this because sometimes, you know, the screens, they just hide behind the photo. So anyway, saturated adiabatic lapse rate. So in contrast to the dry adiabatic lapse rate, okay, which is denoted by gamma D, okay, this is what we have seen just now, gamma D, and which is constant, the numerical value of the saturated adiabatic lapse rate, gamma S, varies with pressure and temperature, right? It varies with pressure and temperature, and that's because the saturation vapor pressure, the saturation vapor pressure depends on the temperature. It's a function of pressure and temperature. We had discussed earlier, right? Because if the temperature is colder, the saturation occurs quickly, okay? If the temperature is warmer, the saturation takes more time because it needs more amount of water vapor to get saturated, right? Its water vapor holding capacity increases with temperature, right? And that's why we had discussed earlier that during the winter season, when the temperature falls down quickly, especially in the morning time, the saturation reaches very fast and we see the fog, right? The relative humidity becomes 100% quickly, right? So, accordingly, the saturated adiabatic lapse rate, gamma S, also varies. And it's a function of the pressure and temperature. It depends upon the amount of water vapor in the air, right? So actual value of gamma S, we have seen, ranges from about 4 Kelvin per kilometer near the ground in warm, humid air masses to typical value of 6 to 7 Kelvin per kilometer in the mid-troposphere. And as you see, gamma S is always less than gamma D. Gamma S is always less than gamma D because gamma D is about 9.8 degree Kelvin per kilometer, whereas this is only about 6 to 7 per kilometer in the mid-troposphere. So lines that show the rate of decrease in temperature with height of a parcel of air that is rising or sinking in the atmosphere under saturated adiabatic or pseudo-adiabatic conditions are called the saturated adiabates or pseudo-adiabates. You have seen these lines in the diffigram, right? These lines you have seen already in the diffigrams. They are the curved lines, right, on the diffigram, okay? On the SQT log P chart, these are the curved, curved green lines that diverge upward and tend to become parallel to the dry adiabates, okay, as you go upwards. Now let's see how we can derive the expression for the rate of change of temperature with height, that is gamma S, of a parcel of air undergoing a saturated adiabatic process. Okay. Now let's see. We assume that this quantity rho times LV, where rho is the density, LV is the latent heat of vaporization, times rate of change of WS, that is the saturation mixing ratio with respect to pressure at a constant temperature, okay, is much smaller than 1. That's what we assume, okay. This expression, rate of change of saturation mixing ratio with pressure at a constant temperature is much smaller than 1. Let's assume that. So substituting the definition from the definition of geopotential, right? If you remember, geopotential is equal to G times dz, and which is equal to minus alpha dp, okay? Minus alpha dp. Earlier we have seen that during the discussion of first law of thermodynamics, into this expression dq is equal to d of h plus phi is equal to d of cpt plus phi, okay? So this is the what we are taking it from the definition of the first law of thermodynamics and the definition of the geopotential. You have seen it earlier in our equation number 14, old equation 14. So substitute from that equation, that is this one into this one, then we can get dq is equal to Cp dt plus g dz, where dq is a change in the, now here Q is used for indicating both a specific humidity as well as the amount of heat. While discussing in the thermodynamics, first law of thermodynamics, we use this symbol Q both for, increment in the heat of a system, right? Whereas here we are saying that it is dq equal to Cp dt plus gz, the same thing. But we also use this Q for the specific humidity. So sometimes you have to be careful. Same symbol used conventionally for representing the heat added to a system or the specific humidity. So it depends on the context, in what context we are talking about, right? So if the saturation ratio of air with respect to water is WS, that is the saturation mixing ratio, the quantity of heat dq, right? This is the dq, that is the quantity of heat released into or absorbed from a unit mass of dry air due to condensation or evaporation of liquid water is LV times DWS, where LV is the latent heat of vaporization. Okay. Latent heat of condensation or vaporization. Okay. Therefore, we can write that expression as minus LV DWS into Cp dt plus GZ, GDZ. We have just substituted dq from here. Okay. The value of dq here. And that is the first law of thermodynamics. Okay. So now in this case, it has become the change in the saturation the specific humidity times the latent heat of vaporization, right? So if we neglect the small amount of water vapor associated with a unit mass of dry air, which are also warmed or cooled by the release or absorption of the latent heat, then Cp in this expression, this one, is the specific heat at constant pressure of dry air. Because the quantity of water vapor in air is much smaller compared to the dry air. So we can replace this or treat this Cp as the specific heat for the dry air. Okay. Now dividing both the sides of this equation by Cp times dz and rearranging the terms, we can obtain dt by dz is equal to minus LV by Cp, dWs by dz times minus g by Cp, okay? Where this indicates the rate of change of temperature with height, dt by dz, right? Rate of change of temperature with height. And this is the case of moist adiabatic process, because we are discussing the moist adiabatic process, right? Is given by this one, right? Because this is the rate of change of saturation mixing ratio with height, okay, minus G by Cp. And this can be written as equal to minus LV by Cp times dz, it is just algebraic manipulation, times dWs by dp at constant temperature times dp plus dWs by dp. We just try to differentiate this, expand this and differentiate this, okay, from here. Okay, so dWs by dt at constant pressure times dt and dWs by dp at constant temperature times dp minus g by Cp. Okay, this is what we get. Therefore, we can write dt by dz, again, just try to rearrange the terms, times 1 plus LV by Cp times rate of change of saturation mixing ratio with temperature at a constant pressure equal to minus G by Cp, 1 plus this expression. Okay. So, see the difference. Now, this is the rate of change of saturation mixing ratio with the pressure at a constant pressure, whereas this is the rate of change of saturation mixing ratio at constant pressure. I mean, with pressure at constant temperature, times dP by dT. Okay. There are simple algebraic manipulations you can derive yourself also on the paper. Okay. I mean, if you can do that, that will be good for you. Okay. So, alternatively, using the hydrostatic equation in the last term here on the right side. Now, do you remember what is the hydrostatic equation? Anybody? What is the hydrostatic equation? Does anyone remember? Yes or no? No? What is the hydrostatic equation?
Dp by dS is equal to minus zero.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. That is the hydrostatic equation, right? That is the hydrostatic equation. That is dP divided by dz is equal to minus g times rho, right? This is the hydrostatic equation. Okay. So if you substitute from this equation, okay, on this one, then we can get rho gamma s, which is dt by dz, right? Now we are denoting dt by dz as gamma s. Okay, that is the lapse rate of this saturated moist adiabatic or saturated moist adiabatic lapse rate is equal to, now B arranging this term, G by Cp, all these things divided by this one. Okay, or we can write gamma s, that is the saturated lapse, moist adiabatic lapse rate is equal to gamma d, because g by cp is gamma d, okay, g by cp is gamma d, times this one divided by this one, right? 1 minus rho times lb, rate of change of saturation mixing ratio with pressure at constant temperature, divided by 1 plus lb by cp, times rate of change of saturation mixing ratio with temperature at constant pressure, okay. So it can be shown that rho times LV, rate of change of saturation mixing ratio with pressure at a constant temperature, is approximately equal to 0.12. Okay, this we can very easily. So if we neglect this small term, because 0.12 is a very small term in the last equation, then we obtain gamma s, which is equal to dT by dz, rate of change of temperature with height, is approximately equal to gamma d divided by 1 plus lb by cp, times rate of change of saturation mixing ratio with temperature at a constant pressure, which is the moist adiabatic lapse rate. This is the expression for the moist adiabatic lapse rate. Okay. So this is a very, very important expression, because many times, you will have to compute on the graphical form, why did not writing? Okay, because I'm in the, I think, slide mode, that's why I did not writing. So, this is the actual expression for the moist adiabatic lapse rate. And when we are writing a computer program, okay, when we are writing the computer program for a model, then we have to compute this. We have to compute this, because we have to construct a moist adiabatic computationally for in the models, right? Because manually you can compute from the graph using the Tiffy graph, right? You can compute the moist adiabatic lapse rate on a Tiffy graph, but when we are writing a model computer program, then you have to code this, and accordingly you have to use this formula for that, because based upon that you can find out what is the temperature inside the cloud. Okay, what is the temperature inside the cloud? Say for example, groups. Let me see if I can start a new slide. Insert new slide. Okay. Suppose if you have a cloud like this one, right? Then inside the cloud, the temperature. The temperature inside the cloud or temperature profile inside the cloud, let's say this is the TS, temperature inside the cloud, or let us say this is TC, cloud temperature. At different levels, the temperature of the cloud at different levels in the vertical, okay, and this is the T, that is the temperature of the surrounding air, right? The two different things. One is the temperature of the surrounding air. Oops, क्या हो गया? I did not try. Just trying to something happened. Trying to design. No. Not very familiar with this. Okay. I hope now it works. So suppose. Okay. So suppose this is the base of the cloud. Okay. Also known as the LCL. Okay. And this is your ground. This is your ground. Okay. And this is your altitude, Z. Okay. So from your observation, let us say you have got, this is the temperature profile as measured by the radiosun. Is this slide visible to all of you? All of you?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yes, right. Sir. So, okay. So, now, let's say this is the ground, and this is the profile measured by the radiosun of the surrounding air. And a cloud has formed, let us say, here. Okay. Yeah. At this level. So, the temperature profile of the cloud, TC, will be different from T. And because clouds are supposed to be warmer, so that means TC is greater than T. Isn't it? If they are not warmer, they will dissipate. They cannot rise further, right? So TC is supposed to be greater than T. So how do you determine the TC? TC, the cloud temperature is how much? Right? The cloud temperature is how much? As you have discussed earlier, because the clouds are supposed to be saturated, right? And that's why they are warmer and lighter than the surrounding air. And so the temperature inside the cloud is supposed to follow the moist adiabat. The temperature inside the cloud is supposed to follow the moist adiabat. And so to calculate the temperature inside the cloud, you have to use the moist adiabatic lapse rate. Okay, dT by dz, which is in this case is dTc, temperature inside the cloud, right? So what I'm trying to explain is that if we want to calculate the temperature inside the cloud, we have to calculate based upon the moist adiabat. Okay, construct a moist adiabat. And how do we construct a moist adiabat? We construct based upon this equation. This equation, right? we construct or compute, we compute the moisture adiabate based upon this equation. So using this equation, you can calculate the temperature at different levels in the clouds. Okay, so at this level, say this is Z1, this is Z2, this is Z3, okay, and so on. Got the point? So how we can calculate the temperature at different levels inside the cloud is actually based upon the equation of the moist adiabatic lapse rate. Okay. It is based upon the moist adiabatic lapse rate. I have messed up this. Okay. So now let us proceed further. Now let's see what is equivalent potential temperature and the wet wall potential temperature. Okay. Equivalent potential temperature and the wet wall potential temperature. All right. Now, we'll now derive an equation that describes how temperature varies with pressure under conditions of saturated adiabatic ascent or descent. Okay. So, substituting from equation of state, which you know, equation of state, this is the equation of state, P alpha equal to RT, into the first law of thermodynamics, which is this one, dQ equal to Cp dT minus alpha dP. Yeah, you know that already. We get dQ by T is equal to Cp dT by T minus R dT by T. We have just substituted the equation of state into the first law of thermodynamics. Okay. So from the potential temperature equation, that also you know the expression for the potential temperature equation, you know that is theta is equal to T times P0 by P to the power R by Cp. We can write log of theta equal to log of T minus R by Cp log of P plus constant. We just taken the logarithm on both sides. And then after that, differentiating this equation, we can get Cp d theta by theta equal to Cp times dT by T minus R dP by P. Okay. Let's say this is equation number 25. So combining these two equations, 24 and 25, and substituting dQ equal to LV times DWS, where LV is the latent heat of vaporization times the saturation mixing ratio. Now in this equation, we can get minus LV by CPT times DWS equal to theta by theta. Okay. Let's say this is equation number 26. Okay. You can see this derivation also in Wallace and Hobbs book, exercise number 352. We can show that LV by CPT times DWS is equal to approximately equal to D of LVWS divided by CPT. Okay. Let's say this equation is 27. And this we get from question 25 and 26. From these two equations, we can get this equation. Okay. And from there, we can write minus D of LVWS by CPT is approximately equal to D theta by theta. Okay. This expression can be integrated to give minus of LVWS by CPT is approximately equal to log theta plus constant. Okay. After integrating the last equation. This is equation number 28. So we will define a constant of integration in this equation, constant of integration, by requiring that at low temperature, as WS by T tends to zero, the theta tends to become theta E, right? That means when WS, saturation mixing ratio, ratio of this with temperature is tending to zero, that means in a very dry condition, that means all the condensate have fallen down to the ground from the atmosphere, right? So WS by TT is tending to zero, right? Then the temperature that it has achieved after that is indicated by theta e. Okay, theta in that situation is denoted by theta e. And this is the equivalent potential temperature. This is called the equivalent potential temperature. Okay, so we can write LVWSCP by T is equal to log of theta by theta e. Okay, or we can write theta e is approximately equal to theta times e to the power exponential of LVWS divided by CPT. Okay. So now you have got a new definition of the temperature. Okay. You have got a new definition of the temperature. You have seen earlier the potential temperature. Okay. You had seen earlier the virtual temperature. You had seen earlier the wet bulb temperature. Okay. And now you are seeing the equivalent potential temperature. Equivalent potential temperature, which is theta E. So it can be seen that theta E is the potential temperature of a parcel of air when all the water vapor has condensed so that its saturation mixing ratio WS has become zero. Right? As we said, all the condensate has fallen to the ground and WS has become zero. Right? So this is pseudo adiabatic process. And we discussed earlier, it is pseudo adiabatic process. Right? So the temperature in that case with the parcel of air or the air will have is the equivalent potential temperature, right? Equivalent potential temperature. Do you remember the definition of potential temperature? Can somebody define, recall, what is the definition of potential temperature? Somebody, anybody? What is the definition of potential temperature? Everybody is silent.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you define what is yes, potential sir.
Temperature? The potential temperature is temperature of air parcel if it is adiabatically expanded or compressed to 1000 millibar pressure.
Exactly, a reference pressure level 1000 millibar, right? And similarly, we define the equivalent potential temperature in which case when we are expanding or compressing to the reference level, whatever condensate it had, okay, those condensates have been removed from the atmosphere, fallen down as rainfall. And in that situation, the temperature it would attain is the equivalent potential temperature. Equivalent potential temperature. Okay. So hence, the equivalent potential temperature of an air parcel is the temperature it would attain when the air is expanded, that is lifted pseudo adiabatically until all the vapor has condensed and released its latent heat and fallen out. The air is then compressed dry adiabatically to the standard pressure level of 1000 millibar, okay, at which point it will attain the temperature theta E. Okay, right? So the equivalent potential temperature is the temperature of an air parcel which is lifted or expanded, okay, pseudo adiabatically until all the vapor has been condensed and the latent heat has been released and fallen out. And then the air is again brought back or compressed dry adiabatically to the standard pressure level of 1000 millibar. So at which point it will retain the temperature theta E. That is called the equivalent potential temperature. All right. So the equivalent potential temperature is conserved during both dry and saturated adiabatic process. Very important statement. Okay. This is a very important statement. It says that equivalent potential temperature is conserved during both dry and saturated adiabatic process. If you recall, we had said that the potential temperature theta is a conserved quantity. We had said that earlier. But that conserved quantity is only during an adiabatic process. Right? The conservation is no longer valid when it is a saturated adiabatic process. Okay. Theta is not conserved in a saturated adiabatic process. Whereas the equivalent potential temperature remains conserved both during dry and saturated adiabatic process. Okay, so you must remember this difference and definition, which are very important. You will get small questions like this. Okay, so if the line of constant equivalent potential temperature, that is the pseudo adiabats, right? That is the curve, green lines on the Tiffy gram, that passes through the wet bulb temperature, a parcel of air, is traced back on a SQ2 log P chart to the point where it intersects with 1000 millibar. The temperature at this intersection is a wet bulb potential temperature, theta W. Now look at the definition. There was the equivalent potential temperature, and this is the wet bulb potential temperature, okay, of the air parcel. So that means wet bulb potential temperature is just the temperature of the parcel at the intersection, okay, at 1000 millibar, okay. Like the equivalent potential temperature, the wet bulb potential temperature is conserved during both dry and saturated adiabatic process, okay. So even the wet bulb potential temperature theta W is conserved during both dry and saturated adiabatic process, okay. So when the height rather than the pressure is used as the independent variable, the conserved quantity during the adiabatic or pseudo-adiabatic ascent or descent with water undergoing transitions between liquid and vapor phases is the moist static energy. Okay, another important parameter, very important parameter, moist static energy. You had seen earlier the dry static energy. You remember? We had discussed earlier the dry static energy. What is the dry static energy? You recall the previous diagram. If you recall the previous diagram, the dry static energy so we had discussed this earlier, dry static energy, and that was equal to, if you remember, do you remember the expression for the dry static energy? It was equal to CPT plus ZZ. Does anybody remember this? We had discussed it earlier in one of the previous classes. Yes or no? Everybody is silent. That means, yes, we had discussed this earlier. And we had said that this is nothing but the enthalpy. And this was nothing but, what was this? What is this, GZ? What is this, GZ? Potential energy. Of the air parcel. We had discussed this earlier in one of the previous classes. So this is the dry static energy. Okay, this is the dry static energy. Now we have got, this is conserved during a dry adiabatic process. Okay, this is conserved in a dry adiabatic process. Okay, dry static energy is conserved during a dry adiabatic process. Okay. Now we have got another quantity called the moist adiabatic process, moist static energy. Okay, and it turns out that the moist static energy is equal to CPT plus GZ plus LBQP. Okay, this is the definition of the moist static energy. Okay. And my battery is going down shortly, so we have to finish the class quickly. Okay, so Now, if you remember, this is nothing but the dry static energy. Cpt plus Gz is dry static energy. And this is the amount of heat added because of the condensation. Lv times Qv, where Lv is the latent heat of vaporization times Qv, the mixing ratio. Okay. So, where T is the temperature of the air parcel and Qv is the specific humidity or the saturation mixing ratio, nearly equal to W mixing ratio. Okay. So, the first term on the right hand side of this one is the enthalpy. Okay. We have just discussed this is the enthalpy. Okay. The second term is the potential energy we have just discussed. And the third term is the latent heat content. Okay. The first two terms are the dry static energy. We have just seen the dry static energy. Okay. So when air is lifted dry adiabatically, enthalpy is conjugated into potential energy, is converted into potential energy. And the latent heat content remains unchanged during the dry adiabatic process. In saturated adiabatic ascent, the energy is exchanged among all three terms. On the right hand side of this equation, potential energy increases while the enthalpy and the latent heat content both decrease. Okay. However, the sum of the three terms remain constant. This remains constant. Okay. So during a moist adiabatic ascent or descent, the moist static energy remains conserved. Okay. Quickly. Just a minute. Okay, so we shall quickly see the Norman's rule. What is Norman's rule? Norman's rule states that on a SQT log B chart, the lifting condensation level of an air parcel is located at the intersection of the potential temperature line that passes through the point located by the temperature and pressure of the air parcel. The equivalent potential temperature, that is pseudo adiabate, that passes through the point located by the wet bulb temperature and pressure of the air parcel, and the saturation mixing ratio line that passes through the point determined by the dew point and pressure of the air. This is the Norman's rule. So what does it say? If you look at graphically it states that when you are lifting a parcel, okay, when lifting a parcel, this is a familiar diagram to you, I believe. Okay, and you have got the isobaric levels, okay, vertical levels, pressure, and all these red lines are basically your isotherms, okay, and this is your theta line, that is your dry adiabate. Okay, this is the isotherm, this is the dry adiabatic thermodynamic diagram, if you remember. Okay. So this is the equivalent potential temperature line, that is the moist adiabatic. Moist adiabatic line. Okay, and these are the mixing ratio lines or saturation mixing ratio lines. Okay. So the Norman's rule states that on a SQT log P chart, this is SQT log P diagram, the lifting condensation level of an air parcel, LCL, that is the lifting condensation level of an air parcel, is located at the intersection of the potential temperature, this is the potential temperature line, that passes through the point located by the temperature and pressure of the air parcel. Okay, this is the pressure and this is the this is the temperature. So, whatever is the temperature nearest to this line, these are the isotherms. Okay, parcel. The equivalent potential temperature line, that is pseudo adiabate, that is this line. that passes through the point located by the wet wall temperature. This is the wet wall temperature TW. This is the wet wall temperature. Okay, this is T temperature. This is the wet wall temperature, and this is the TD, the dew point temperature. Okay, temperature, wet wall temperature, dew point temperature, wet bulb potential temperature, theta W. This is the wet bulb potential temperature. Okay, this is theta E, the equivalent potential temperature, and this is theta, potential temperature. See, so many varieties of temperature, right? Air temperature, wet bulb temperature, wet bulb potential temperature, dew point temperature, equivalent temperature, and equivalent potential temperature, and potential temperature. So, according to the Norman's rule, the LCL is located at the intersection of theta E, theta, the dry adiabat, and the intersection of the temperature line. Okay, temperature line passes through the point of located by the well bulb temperature. So, if you extend down to this, okay, at the standard pressure level, if you look at this, this is 1000 millibar. And as per the definition, this is standard pressure level. So, the temperature at this standard pressure level of theta is the wet bulb potential temperature passing through the point determined by the dew point and the pressure of the air. Okay. So, this is what is the Norman's rule. Okay. This is a very important rule and interesting because this is the basis of all these, you know, calculation or determination of the LCL, LFC, etc., on a T5 gram. Okay. This rule is illustrated in this figure. For the case of an air parcel with temperature T, pressure P, dew point temperature TD, and wet bulb temperature TW. Okay. It can be seen that if T, P, and TD are known, okay, and TW, the wet bulb temperature, may be readily determined using the Norman's rule. Also, by extrapolating the E line that passes through the TW, this line, extrapolate down to the 1000 millibar, the wet bulb potential temperature W may be found. You can calculate the wet bulb potential temperature, okay, theta W. So, this is the Norman's rule. I'll just discuss one more slide, net effects of ascent followed by descent. So, when a parcel of air is lifted above its LCL, you have seen the LCL in the previous diagram. Okay, if the air parcel is lifted above this level, okay, air parcel lifted above this level, so that condensation occurs, and if the products of the condensation falls out as precipitation, the latent heat gained by the air during this process will be retained by the air if the parcel returns to its original level. Okay, already we have discussed. Effects of the saturated ascent coupled with the adiabatic descent are, number one, there is a net increase in the temperature and potential temperature of the parcel, a decrease in the moisture content as indicated by change in mixing ratio, or relative humidity, dew point, or wet bulb temperature, and no change in the equivalent potential temperature because that remains conserved, or wet bulb potential temperature, which are conserved quantities for air parcels undergoing both dry and saturated processes. Okay, so this is actually the statement, same statement given, which we had discussed earlier graphically on the graph. Okay, so this is what happens when an air parcel is lifted above the LCL. Okay, and the three things that occur are net increase in temperature and potential temperature of the parcel, a decrease in the moisture content as indicated by the change in mixing ratio, relative humidity, dew point, or wet bulb temperature, and no change in the equivalent potential temperature or wet bulb potential temperature, which are conserved quantity for air parcels undergoing both dry and saturated processes. Okay. So, we shall stop here today, only 1:35. But you must know, read these things carefully and understand, because they are very important, okay, for your understanding of how the cloud forms, what happens, you know, when air parcel is lifted, okay, upwards either because of the convection or because of the mechanical lifting, etc., what would happen? Okay, and if it is followed by a descent of the air parcel, when there is an ascent and then followed by a descent, then what would happen? What will happen to the air parcel? Those things should be very, very clear to you. Okay, you must read that to understand again. All right. So today we stop here. Okay. Now we shall continue on Monday. Okay. Is there any question? Anybody has any question?
No, sir.
So we shall stop sharing the PowerPoint. Okay. So everything was clear? No doubt, right? I assume no doubt because everybody is silent. So, all right. So, in that case, did anybody miss the attendance at the beginning? Anyone who came late? So, nobody missed the attendance. So, that means everybody came. Okay, good. So, fine. So, we stopped the recording. And stop recording.